So, hello again. Right. So today I'm going to talk to you about one of my favourite things, which is the Carboniferous. So my name is Katie Strang. Most of you will know me already. I'm secretary and one of the trustees for the Scottish Geology Trust. So I'm going to do a brief introduction of just what I'm talking about in terms of the Carboniferous. So the Carboniferous period extended from about 360 million years ago to about 300 million years ago. And at this point, it's really interesting because of our geological setting. Scotland was near to the equator, and I'll talk a bit about that later. But this period of time was really exciting in terms of fossils and evolution. We had tetrapods moving onto land, really, really exciting. But weirdly, what I'm going to start by talking about first is coal. So most of you will be aware that Scotland, particularly the Central Belt, is very famous for its coal deposits. And most people will know someone or sort of know of someone who has worked or has family who's worked in the coal mines. For myself, my granddad, him and his family worked in the mines around about Cowdenbeath. And it's one of those things where the heritage and that legacy of our industry is still very prominent throughout the Central Belt. And these two maps here, the one on the left is showing you the distribution of the coal fields, and the one on the right is showing you the Britain's largest urban areas by geographical size. 9 out of 10 of them, obviously not including London there. But you can see that they are distributed on the Central Belt very clearly around where we have these coal deposits. And it's really interesting to look at history and how society has been shaped by our industry and by these underlying resources that we have. And when you go about places like Fife, there are still very, very prominent landmarks that show you about this history. So on the Fife coast at the Francis Colliery in Dyser, the picture on the left-hand side is one of the old pictures from the 19th century. And this was a huge, huge coal works, very, very famous. And you can still see the winding tower at of the Francis Colliery at Dyser. And one of the things that I notice when you talk to people from the area and local people is quite a lot of people don't actually realise why their village or why their town is situated there, and that it has all just grown around this industry and the underlying geology. And there's some really spectacular sort of anthropogenic deposits that you can see on these parts of the coast, which from the days of when the coal mines were in operation and the coal pits, all the material that they didn't want that was waste would just get dumped. And along the Fife coast, there's certain bits near West and East Weems where you walk up and the cliff is all basically artificial spoil, essentially. And what comes out of there is usually a lot of slag materials. You've got things that have been through kilns, they've been heated, but you also get a lot of really interesting rocks. So when they were sort of mining for the coal, the overburden that they were extracting, quite often there was lots of really interesting fossils and materials. So a lot of the really good fossils we have from the Carboniferous that are in museums, a lot of them came from the old coal workings. And it's a really interesting place to go and have a look. I found bits of minecart washed up, you find kiln shovels, all sorts of really cool sort of industrial heritage there. But you might wonder why I'm talking about coal, considering that it's estimated that about 41% of anthropogenic CO2 comes from coal burning. And we don't have any active coal mines in Scotland at the moment. The last one ceased was Longannet. In sort of 1947, when they were nationalised, to put it in concept, there was 225 collieries registered throughout Scotland at that time. So it was a huge, huge industry, and we were clearly just exploiting the resources. And this map here is a simplified geological map of the Central Belt, just to show you the distribution of the different rocks. And what we have in the Central Belt is a lot of our sort of high hilly areas are usually composed of volcanic rock, which is a lot harder, and then you have the sediments that were laid down. Now, when you go to the early Carboniferous and the Viscean, at that time, Scotland had quite a humid and warm climate, and parts of the area were covered by shallow tropical seas. There was lots of really, really interesting things going on with life. And what the coal fields themselves are mainly from the upper Carboniferous deposits as we go later into the Carboniferous period. There is some in the lower Carboniferous, which are the lowest set of workable coal seams, and they're based mainly around sort of the Dunfermline area. And you can see here that there's a nice distribution that matches clearly with our population density as well. But just to set the scene of Scotland in the Carboniferous, this map on the left here, the green area is showing you, so this is the modern continents and how we look at the moment that's been overlain by where this sort of green area is where we would have had these wetlands. Now, the coal deposits are essentially fossilised wetlands from the Carboniferous. And the brown areas that you can see, the dark brown areas are sort of the higher regions, and then you have the lower regions, which is the light brown areas. And you can see there's this strip of green coming across there, and the line in the middle, that is the equator. So at that point, Scotland was pretty near to the equator. But what we have to remember is in the Carboniferous, the continents weren't distributed like that. So we were actually part of a supercontinent called Pangaea at the time. So that would have impacted the type of conditions that we had. And the image on the right-hand side here is a reconstruction of the vegetation that you would sort of likely see in these coal swamps, which I'm going to go on to talk a wee bit about. So you might be wondering why I decided to concentrate on coal. And I think for me it is that it's really interesting what we can actually gather from this information and look at something that ultimately the burning of coal is in part responsible for where we are now with our climate crisis. But what can these deposits actually tell us that will help inform us for future mitigation of climate change? So the fossil record, particularly in the Carboniferous, is so, so rich. And one of the reasons is because we had so many quarries and mines in operation that a lot of material was extracted and collected, but also because there was such a diversity of life during this time. And when you think about the coal forests and these wetlands, they weren't just one habitat. There were so many different variable habitats within there. And one of the prominent ones would be sort of your river systems, where you have rivers flowing, and the areas of the around the edges where you have floodplains and things are very, very variable. So the kind of life that lives there is not really the kind of life that you would expect to sort of decay and accumulate peat in the sense that we know today. And these are really geographically restricted, these deposits. And the types of fossils that you can find, the types of plants that these are seed ferns. So seed ferns differ from modern ferns because they reproduce using seeds, like the name suggests. And then we have the horsetail-like plants. So on the right-hand side here are a couple of examples of the different plant fossils that you can find from the coal measures in Scotland. And what's incredible about these is just the preservation, the detail that you're getting preserved. I mean, when you think about when leaves fall off a plant now, they just get destroyed and turned to mush. So these are about 300 million years old and are still looking absolutely incredible. You can see lots of structure and lots of detail. So the two on the right are seed ferns, Neuropterus and Alleopterus, and they would have formed and lived in environments that were quite prone to change. So places like floodplains where they might have to adapt or change to the conditions of their environment. But these were not the kind of habitats where you would actually get peat being deposited. You wouldn't be getting carbon actually getting stored, really. As soon as these plants were dying and decayed, that carbon was just going back into the atmosphere. So what we really need to look at is the main peat accumulating habitats. And these were mainly dominated by these lycopsid plants or trees, but they're not true trees like we know today, so they're tree-like. And one of the really cool things about them is that they could grow up to 50 metres in height, which is pretty incredible, but because they didn't have bark like modern trees do, we think they were made from a soft cork-like tissue. And that meant that they were able to grow really, really fast, relatively quickly, and once they reached their full size, they would reproduce using spores. And once they reproduced, they tended to just die. And that means you were getting quite an accumulation of this material, this organic matter. And because of this, the quantities of peat that were accumulating during this time on the forest floor were what eventually became our coal deposits. And the reconstruction on the right here is just showing you the different sort of names that we, genus names that we give to parts of this plant. So because you tend to find these plants broken up and partial, they have a different naming system to what you would do for like a normal fossil. And the two examples on the left are of branches from a lepidodendron, and they quite often get called scale trees because they have this really, really distinct sort of diamond pattern on them. And some of the detail on these is incredible. Now, these ones wouldn't have been probably living in the kind of land that would be depositing this peat because they've been preserved like this. So the one on the left-hand side is actually from a freshwater limestone where we think that's just been washed in and preserved. But being able to look at the details in these kinds of plants can tell us quite a lot about past environments. But when we look back into the Carboniferous, there was actually a lot of really sort of interesting things going on with the climate. So I said that in the early Carboniferous, we had hot and humid climates. As you go into sort of the middle of the Carboniferous, what you see is an expansion of these wetland forests. And this expansion of the wetland forests across parts of North America, UK and China were so vast, and they were such huge carbon sinks that they would have withdrawn a lot of carbon from the atmosphere. And in doing so, that helped to cool our climate. And one of the reasons that the Carboniferous is quite important when we're thinking about climate change in the future is because of how similar the conditions were in terms of we currently are in an interglacial period. It was the same in the Carboniferous. And you had the same sort of distribution of ice at the poles and a warm and tropical humid climate. And tropical regions, and a lot of the land was covered by quite dense and diverse vegetation. And these coal forests, they remained stable for about 10 million years, we think, at the sort of end of the Carboniferous. And it's thought that they started to contract in size, mainly due to just changes in the habitat around them. So changes in drainage, for example, a river changing course, things like that can all have a really profound effect on the environment. But what happened when these forests started to collapse was that we also saw a huge increase in global temperatures. And you don't see it so much in the Northern Hemisphere, but on the Southern Hemisphere in Australia and Argentina, there's a lot of record in the rocks of ice, the ice melting and retreating in these polar regions. So what we have to do is sort of look at these events that happened in the past and work out how do these really relate to future change. And one of the important things is that we need to realise is this difference between how plants were acting back then and the mechanisms that they used to photosynthesise, all that, and compare that to modern plants. And although the wetlands were important habitats for the carbon burial in the Paleozoic, like I said, it is the opposite of a lot of the modern forests. So this picture on the right here is showing a picture of the Amazon River and the kind of wetlands around there. Now, a lot of the modern forests are already saturated carbon sinks, so they have quite a stable pattern of growth and decay. And that means relatively little carbon is actually put into the long-term storage, which is not, if you want to obviously take carbon out of the atmosphere, you want it to be stored somewhere. And the trees usually today are, they're quite large and long-lived, and they're sort of subject to little growth once they're mature, which is very different to these tree-like plants that we had in the Carboniferous, which grew really fast and accumulated all this material. And I've put this picture here of, it's a lump of rock from Cursbeath Quarry, which is near Dunfermline, showing some really nice preserved ripple marks, because there was periods in the Carboniferous where you had huge river systems coming across as well, which is one of the things that impacted these forests. And looking at the late Carboniferous, it can provide really important data points to use in modelling these modern carbon sinks. Now, just to say, I'm a paleontologist, not a climate modeller, so my interest is mainly in looking at the fossils and how we can get more information to tell us more about the future. The insights that we can get into how the climate and the plants are interacting today, we can base that looking at data from the past. So I've put a diagram here of, it's a simplified concept of what's used in climate modelling. So what information do you need? Essentially, the more information you have, the better. And the more data points that you can have, the more accurate your model is going to be. And what we actually see when they run models on past climate from the Carboniferous is that the carbon dioxide levels in the atmosphere range drastically. So some of the models show it up at 700 parts per million, some as low as sort of 100. And so understanding these conditions, we can then sort of use this information to try and understand what plants today are more similar to those in the Carboniferous. And the picture at the bottom is Flanders Moss National Nature Reserve, which is in Stirlingshire. And this is one of the sort of highest sort of peat bogs we have, which is about 8,000 years old. And I just wanted to put that in to show that obviously we still do have these kind of carbon sink environments, just not on the global scale that we had in the Carboniferous. But it is one of the ways that we can look at rocks and sort of hopefully get information that will help us in the future. And it's quite a big topic that there's a lot that I could have talked about. So I'm ending with a picture here of an old limestone mine to just get you thinking about the types of animals that you had living in the tropical oceans as well. We can look at these animals and how they reacted to these different climate events in the Carboniferous and also use that information to help us mitigate future change.
Hello everyone. I'm Professor Larissa Naylor from the University of Glasgow, and Freya and I are going to give this talk in three parts. So I'm going to start, then Freya's going to come on, and then I'm going to come back in at the end. We're talking today on behalf of a very large team. It stems from research that's carried out the second phase of the Dynamic Coast project, which was funded by Scottish Government through CREW. And just before I start, how many of you are aware of Dynamic Coast? Have heard of it? Very few, okay. That's really useful to know. And how many of you are members of the Geological Society? Quite a few, okay. And how many of you think that sea level is rising in Scotland? How many of you think that the isostatic adjustment from the last glacial period is counteracting any sea level rise in Scotland? Quite a few of you. Okay. I hope to change hearts and minds tonight. Oops, sorry. So I'm going to introduce and I'm going to talk about past and future sea level rise. And then Freya's going to come back in talking about the results and implications. Then I'm going to talk about the local context of Edinburgh and exploring adaptation options through the lens of Edinburgh. We have some additional slides that might be useful depending on your questions at the very, very end. And so, sea level. It was very helpful to have that. Katie's excellent talk. But one of the things to think about in that warming period in Carboniferous, the sea levels would have been much different than they are today. So sea level has fluctuated through this long Earth history due to these changes in atmospheric conditions. And that's really important because our current geography, our sense of place, is predicated on the current sea level rise, or in fact, the historic sea level rise. And by historic in this context, I mean the last 200, 300, 400 years of human occupation, similar to Katie's map of where we've chosen to have urban conurbations. So we can start to think about our global and local emissions are contributing and accelerating that sea level rise. And these increasing greenhouse gas concentrations are doing things. So of that diagram at the top, and this is a wonderful diagram from the city of Vancouver, Canada, where I come from, it's their public engagement. These two diagrams come from there. They're superb. And so you have melting glaciers and polar ice caps, which then allows the oceans to more water to enter the oceans in liquid form, both from on land and from melting ice in the ocean itself. And as the ocean absorbs CO2, it warms. Water expands as it warms. And you do have the settling or sinking of land or the rising of land in the Scottish case. And those things affect what's going on with sea level rise. But if you look at the diagram on the right, and actually I bought this dress in Portobello, and it's my sea level rise dress. Inadvertently, didn't think about it at the time. Gave a public lecture. This is my second public lecture in the last month, wearing this dress in Portobello, and realized the connection with some artists. But I digress. But it's worthwhile thinking about existing high tide, existing storm surge, winds and waves. So we all experience those things if we go to the coast in Edinburgh. But what's happening with climate change is you're getting these long-term changes in this average surface elevation of the water. You're adding another layer to the sea level rise cake, the sea level cake, or the ocean cake, actually, is the sea level rise. So everything that's there, the existing high tide is getting amplified. The existing storm surge is getting amplified. The wind and waves are getting amplified. You're raising the level of the water. And unfortunately, there's a lag between us outputting CO2 from getting here today and the response of the oceans. So we're already committed. And so we're here. We're at the very top of what's known as a violin plot. This is known as a violin plot, and we're at the very top of the violin. We're on the red path. Paris Agreement is the blue path. In Scotland, we're on the red path. So we're on track for the worst case scenario for sea level rise, unless we change our behavior, which is why mitigation and net zero are so important. So we have time in decades on the right, we have sea level rise on the left. Our current trajectory, as I said, is the worst case scenario, and we want to bring it down to the lower scenarios through net zero. And so even the best case scenario, we're looking at 20 to 50 centimeter rise in sea level. And if you look in Scotland, there's the past, that's the instrumental record, not the paleo record, but the instrumental record. Then you bring that forward into the future, into 2100. This graph is even more frightening when you go to 2300. The amplification of that curve, the hockey stick, is higher. And so what are some of the implications of sea level rise? This is another wonderful diagram from the City of Vancouver reports. A baby born today can expect to experience a meter of sea level rise by the time they're 80. And it would be worse if we continue on the red path. So you have all these environmental hazards that emerge: coastal erosion, beach loss, steepening, flooding. You have water impacts. You have societal impacts, disruption, damage, repairs, impacts on physical and mental health. These are some of the impacts of an active erosion around Scotland. That's all to set the scene for Freya.
Thank you so much, Larissa. So with that sort of introduction to how we work with sea level rise to try and mitigate the effects and mitigate those impacts, we have been working on the Dynamic Coast Project, which is Scottish Government-funded project, looking into building an evidence base of our past coastal change, how our coast is changing at the moment, and how it may change with those future climate change-driven changes in sea level. So this national project funded by CREW builds this evidence base, and we use a plethora of innovative solutions to mapping, analyzing, and predicting that coastal change. We aim to improve this evidence base so that we can offer Scotland's decision makers an improved awareness of that coastal change so that better decisions can be made for the future. So, prior to 2015, we didn't really have any national understanding of how Scotland's coast was changing. In 2012, the Climate Change Risk Assessment recommended that coastal change maps are required for all of Scotland. So that basically kicked off the start of the Dynamic Coast Project's work. So in 2017, the Dynamic Coast Project established a historical time series of coastal change in all of Scotland over the last 130 years. This work illuminated the changes that had happened and were happening across Scotland's shores on a national scale for the first time. So we got a glimpse into how, from the past rates of change, how that those changes might then propagate forward into the future if we just take those past rates of change between those different time frames. But there was no accounting for sea level rise in any of those projections. We can see them in the middle just here, those projections from our first phase of the Dynamic Coast Project. So this second phase of the project that has been delivered this summer incorporates an enhanced evidence base that we now have and also incorporates modeling shoreline change based on future sea level rise as well. So this second phase of Dynamic Coast aimed to enhance our evidence base that we had already established in phase one with the incorporation of new high water lines and the modeling of future shorelines with sea level rise using these new shoreline observations. So I'll cover that more in depth just shortly. We used a lot of different topographic profiles and topographic models. We used aerial imagery. We went out into the field and we built up that national evidence base so that we could have more data to arm ourselves with. We also undertook studies in erosion-enhanced flooding to be able to put a timestamp on each flood polygon around Scotland to gain an understanding of the areas at risk of flooding and erosion. And to help form adaptation in these areas. Given the potential for erosion to enhance flood risk to the low-lying terrain inland in places such as Golspie and Montrose, as we've seen here, and in St. Andrews as well, we aim to identify and map natural coastal flood defenses to assess the potential for their protective function to be impacted by future erosion. Coastal dunes do a very good job at actually protecting us from any adverse effects of flooding when sea levels rise. So we want to be able to protect those natural assets so that they can sort of protect us as well. We mapped out vegetation edges to give a greater understanding of the local scale longer-term vulnerability that may not have been reflected in those shorter, more variable changes in the shorelines as well. So as well as giving a national overview of past, present, and predicted changes across Scotland, we've been able to assess key local sites representing a range of geomorphologies, coastal assets, and change histories. From these detailed key sites, we can use our topographic mapping to quantify the volumes of sediment that have been transported across the shore and the 3D changes that have taken place, as we can see up here in Golspie. Those 3D changes then help to inform the costing of repairs and realignment and adaptation options for the people and the stakeholders at those key sites. And just as coastal erosion is spatially variable across the country, so too is the vulnerability of the communities to this erosion, which we've also mapped for the first time in Scotland. This ensures that adaptation strategies account for specific place-based contexts of affected communities to mitigate the impact of coastal erosion. And this aids the Scottish public sector in designing and targeting socially just adaptation measures and community engagement plans. We're also applying new novel techniques in satellite imagery analysis to automatically map out the intertidal zone, which has notoriously been a very hard zone to map out just based on the fluctuations of sea level being able to actually get onto the beach. But using satellite imagery, in which we have thousands of satellites flying over Earth every day, we can now build up a much, much larger evidence base to help us inform, to help inform those decisions that we make. So all of this data that I've spoken about gives an understanding of the past and present changes happening across Scotland's shores, but it's our future we need to look at if we need to make the right decisions now. In order to quantify and properly assess the impacts of sea level rise on coastal change rates, the second phase of the Dynamic Coast Project gathered and analyzed a range of data sets to assess how our coasts in Scotland are changing now and how they might vary in the near future. So we obtained past rates of change from our shoreline position evidence base, which we already have. And we combined those current shoreline positions with bathymetry contours so that we could obtain a nearshore slope, which is very important for figuring out how the lateral position of the shoreline then changes with sea level rise. Existing defenses were mapped alongside the coastal type and the underlying susceptibility to erosion models from the first phase of dynamic coast to give us an idea of where might be more resilient versus less resilient on that soft coast. And the UK CP18 climate projections of sea level rise were then used in various ways to analyze how rising waters in the future may affect flood levels and shoreline positions. All of this data was then attached to cross-shore transects across every erodible shore in Scotland. That equates to about 200,000 transects, all spaced at 10 meters evenly. And it represents about 5.5 million calculations that we undertook in order to plan out and see how our shorelines might change with that sea level rise. So using this data, we took those models of sea level change and we fed them into a model of coastal change that accounts for historic shoreline change as well as the effects of rising sea level. From this, decadal future shoreline positions were able to be mapped out across all of our erodible shores, which you can see here in the middle. So this gives us an immense insight into the locations and lifespans of at-risk beaches all the way across Scotland. This is a national and regional scale assessment, and so it should not be used for local or property level assessments. But it still gives us a great insight into planning and facilitates that planning, not just a mark in the calendar, but more a sort of broad overview of when we might expect the position of the shore to approach inland. Just as the past is the key to the future in geological terms, so too do the past rates of shoreline change affect the model shorelines predicted into the future. So if we use different shoreline dates that are taken from just these snapshots in time, we may get a slightly different prediction for the future just based on those slightly underlying changes that might be happening across the shore that we're not able to map just because we have one shoreline from the 1800s, one shoreline from the 1970s, and then a handful from the modern day. However, this overall direction of change that's anticipated in Dynamic Coast 2 remains a very robust view for the future. So as an example here, we have the decadal predictions on the left-hand side showing a more severe retreat where the past change has been more significant in those shorelines. So we base it on the past rates of change, but also on sea level rise, improving upon that first phase of dynamic coast, which only used those geometric change rates. So we can see that the harbor has also been left out of the analyses due to the presence of hard defenses. So we're understanding what the present defenses that we have and the present sort of changes in resilience that we might have across all of our coasts are in modeling that future. We've undertaken this modeling across multiple pathways of sea level rise, meaning that we can obtain a range of futures for coastal erosion to further aid planning and adaptation. An important facet of adaptive planning at the coast is having a range of possible outcomes so that we can plan the best response to the current path that we're on, kind of like a choose-your-own-adventure book. By intersecting erosion predictions with information about the built and natural environment, we have been able to quantify the value of assets at risk of erosion. At the Neolithic village of Scarabray in Orkney, here on the left, we have been able to identify that the lowering of beach elevations due to that erosion and due to that sea level rise will further expose the toe of the existing seawall that protects the Neolithic village. And this will make the site even more vulnerable to storms. In more urban settings, like across Lothian, as we are here, for example, we can only apply this approach to soft, erodible shores, but we still expect 104 properties and 1.9 kilometers of road to be impacted by retreating shorelines by 2050 under this highest emissions climate scenario of sea level rise. These maps are all available at dynamiccoast.com, and they highlight the assets, infrastructure, and communities at risk and focus on our points for adaptation. And with that, I'll pass back over. Oh, I got one more slide. I forgot. So with this analysis, Dynamic Coast has shown that erosion is affecting more of our erodible coast than was previously known. The rate and extent of erosion will increase for low, medium, and high emission scenarios. By 2050, we expect 58% of soft shores will be eroding, with a national mean erosion distance inland of 11 meters. That is in a low emission scenario. And this jumps to 72% and 14 meters, respectively, under a high emissions sea level rise scenario. 20 billion pounds worth of assets currently lie within 50 meters of the coast in Scotland. And 1.2 billion pounds worth of assets may be at risk of erosion by 2050 if we do nothing to curb our emissions and adapt to climate change now. By adapting and mitigating, we could get the assets at risk of erosion down to only 800 million pounds. We've been able to show that 14.5 billion pounds of assets lie behind soft natural coasts, whereas only 5 billion pounds worth are currently protected by hard assets, which highlights the potential for nature-based solutions for protecting our assets and adapting to coastal change. And as these changes take place, we also need to be aware that some coastal communities may feel the effects more than others due to social disadvantage mapped out across the country. All right, now I'll pass over.
Hermione, can you let me know how much time we have? Because I didn't clock when we started. Okay, fabulous. Okay, yeah, bye. Okay. Oh, sorry.
I'll take off my mask.
Sorry, this yo-yo of mask, no mask. It's very strange. I had to get a PCR test, or not PCR, I took a lateral flow test, we both did, before we left the building in Glasgow, before we came. So it was like, mask, lateral flow test, oh, and a talk. So, anyways, Freya has set this science up very well. Hopefully, those of you that were unequivocal about sea level rise are now more understanding of the risks we face, but also those impacts on our landscape. And if there's one thing you take away is that the coast is dynamic. It always has been, it always will be. We've chosen to fix our assets and our lines on maps. So please refer to it as the coast and the shore and avoid the use of a line. And so adaptation is, what do we do with all of that information? How do we digest it? How do we transform it into something that allows climate resilient development futures for that baby in that sea level rise curve? That's really what we want to do. And so it's a social process by which society learns to adapt to that dynamic and changing coast to improve the resilience of these communities. Erosion is different than flooding. The IPCC talks about adaptation and accommodation to flooding. We can't put houses on stilts to manage erosion. We can't not have housing and put your car parks on the ground floor like you can with flooding. We're talking about loss of land, release of sediment that can be used elsewhere. It's quite a fundamental difference, and it's really important in the context of Scotland. And so we need to make that space for that house. And the UK government's 2021 risk assessment said adaptation action has failed to keep pace with mitigation. If you think about the current Whitehall government, it's much easier to talk about green recovery in terms of green jobs and mitigation and low carbon. We're talking about trying to reduce risk. We're talking about having to move difficult things like assets. It's much harder to tether that to job creation. And the benefits are often much more softer. They're about that social resilience. So it's a different thing. And so how do we manage this? So for key infrastructure assets, we are likely to choose to retain and build higher seawalls. I'll show you some pictures in a minute that might make us think twice about that, including that straight ahead of us. That is what Japan did after Hurricane Fukushima. The residents were in uproar. It was a wonderful photo essay in The Guardian where it came from. The red text is quite a recent report from the Environment Agency. There is a 5 to 8 times uplift in the repair costs. less for the maintenance, but the maintenance and repair cost of managing hard assets is going to skyrocket. That's before the current materials crisis, by the way. And in selected places, society thus might choose to resist erosion through using these very conventional techniques. Selected places. In the majority of places, that's too expensive, or it's a trade-off society may not want to make. We need to start to use these nature-based solutions to start to accommodate erosion. This is New York City. These are drawings and high-level concepts that were done after Hurricane Sandy. They're talking about building back and building high berms where people can have a view, but those berms provide protection from storm surges and flood risk. Not sure about the erosion piece for it. So by being sea level wise, it means that coastal management isn't about decisions just at the coast. It's about placing them in these climate resilient development plans. So myself, Ali Rennie, and Jim Hansen and the team particularly have been liaising with urban planners as physical geographers and scientists. And so we need to make climate smart, intergenerational, flexible decisions on land today to make space for that 14 and a half billion of nature to continue to do its thing. Because it wants to respond to sea level by rolling landwards. We need to give it that space. It's what we call accommodation space. So internationally, we're creating these dynamic adaptation pathways. You'll see it in other circles. It's used a lot. But you're doing this by preparing a range of resilience options. They buy us time. So in the short term, we might want to recharge a beach. We might want to fix a defense. But in the long term, is that the best option for society? But particularly with erosion, going back to those differences between accommodating flooding and accommodating erosion, the urgency of the now is much greater. Because if we do not safeguard the land that is low value, then we are going to increase our costs and increase our societal disruption by having to move more assets later. And so these two examples I'm going to talk about are referring to areas that aren't currently built up to some degree. So we're monitoring change of a beach using something like all the wonderful things Freya talked about. We're deciding to replenish a beach. That gives us time to adapt. And that allows that beach to roll landwards to continue to protect society. If there are assets there, it builds us time to accommodate those assets. In places where we have low-grade current development, light industrial warehouses, whiskey houses, that kind of thing, that could be elsewhere, that have no need to be right next to the coast or right next to the estuary, then we could prepare to adapt on land now. That means you're not redeveloping your whiskey sheds with high-end houses that have to be moved later. So then no future relocation is needed. It avoids a development lock-in. And so let's look at Edinburgh. Most of Edinburgh is at the coast is made ground. Historically, it was the sea. These set of images at Granton show you. That X was in the intertidal prior to 1893, or at 1893 map. Now, it's where it is there. So that whole light purple area was reclaimed. And the position of the seawall today is that X. Importantly, this area wasn't reclaimed, if you look at the map, which we'll see in a minute. But the design life of existing assets is short. Maintenance budgets have been cut by austerity. Natural beachfront and habitat is limited. And there's no shoreline management plan for the city because of lack of staff and financial resources. This is some of the state of the defenses after the 2010 storm. The damage was £700. It wasn't big enough to get central government funding. So other projects for the city had to be put on hold to repair that. Is that what we want for our children, for social care? Repair costs meant other investments were delayed. We also are encouraging active travel and decarbonizing. And if your cycle path and your route to work is disrupted, how's that going to gel? And so you've got this made ground. You've got these hard defenses, as Freya said very eloquently in her talk. that changes how we can model and where we can model a map. So if you go home and look at these maps, these red lines are only in small places in Edinburgh. That does not mean there's no underlying erosion risk. It means there's defended and the models don't work. And so we had to create an alternative method for Edinburgh. So the coast to the right of this section, is in this, sorry, I'm not, you know what, it's done my notes slightly differently. Sorry about that. So basically, what we've got here is modeling of what's happening. That green line is a cross section through there. And there's the current seawall. And if you roll back, there's the vegetation edge, if we allow it to roll back naturally. So we're talking about 20 meters of retreat, quite a large amount of retreat. Where we can model is where it wasn't reclaimed. That's what the shore, that bay, naturally wants to do. It's also where, with the current grant and development, it's been decided that the services are too expensive to move now under the road and it's going to be defended. If we look at this case study, you've at the bottom, the pink lines, 1985 and 2014, dynamic coast one didn't show any change because there was no change because we'd reclaimed it and it was defended through the life of our instrumental ordnance survey mapping record. You add the modeling, you can start to see what wants to happen with the change. So what we did is we took a series of data that made ground layer, modeled and wave overtopping modeling of flooding of that development site and the underlying erosion susceptibility model. And we used all of that data to draw these lines of adaptation scenarios. This is the same stretch. The AECOM used some of the dynamic coast data. That is what, if you want to build in that space, the wall would have to be the height of that woman standing on the seawall. Imagine that along that space. Is that what we want our coast to look like? Or what we can do, so originally the city was going to put 600 houses right in that red zone, and they're being moved. It's not through the political stage because there's fewer social houses, so there's a trade-off, but they're planning to put park. That is a climate-resilient development future. That is combining coastal flood risk and land management together. That is the kind of decision-making we need to take. And so what Jim and I have been doing in particular is advising on things like the city plan. The city plan made no mention of coastal erosion, of sea level rise, of any of these risks. We ask them to revise it. Because doing so gives that future flexibility. It safeguards space. And so that's what climate resilient and climate smart development can look like. So in a summary, coastal change is speeding up. We need to be sea level wise, we need to be erosion wise. So things like flood risk schemes need to say flood and erosion risk management at the coast. We need to build sustainable homes in low risk places, even if that means changing our density. We need to think about these land-based adaptation and nature-based solutions can help us achieve this. And that will help us deliver against these sustainable development goals, which we're obligated to do. So thank you for listening. A little bit somber.
Excellent. Very sombering, but a very perfect kind of introduction, really, to what I want to talk to you about, which is how we can try to take steps forward to meet our net zero goals and how the Geology of Scotland can help us to do that. So, thank you for setting the scene and giving us quite an eye-opening look at the impacts that are right happening on our doorstep. So my name is Dr. Katrina Edelman. I work at Edinburgh University, geologist by training, and now working in that how we can use geology for the net zero transition. So that's me, and I'm going to talk to you about how we can utilise our geology in Scotland to support this energy transition and try to help it towards net zero emissions and minimise the risk of losing our lovely coast to rising sea levels and erosion. So we know what the problem is. we're all very aware of this problem. Yeah, I mean, I don't know how many times you have to see this, but it is really important to just keep reminding ourselves of why we're doing this. If you look at the figure on the far, I never know my right from a left, but far away, you can see that nearly three quarters of our emissions are related to energy, in be that transport, heating, however that is. So three quarters of the emissions that we're putting into the atmosphere globally are related to energy. So this is something we really do need to tackle. And we are doing things to tackle it. Of course we are. You know, we're making really great progress in our renewables. So we really are sort of decarbonising our electricity. We're doing energy efficiency, which is helping, and trying to use some low-carbon technologies. And that's great. And if you look at the graph nearest me, you can see that very dark red line, that's our electricity emissions. So you can see that by 2020, that they're really dropping off. So we're really, you know, we're on track with that. But if you look at the other sectors in that diagram, so this is from the carbon brief, this is them anticipating the emissions from these sectors under the current plans. You can see that transport in blue, you can see that the industry in yellow, and you can see the homes, so heating in purple. We're really not doing enough to tackle these. Yeah, we need new pathways to deal with this. We really need sort of additional solutions to try and help us with that. So one of the solutions that's being increasingly talked about at the moment anyway, certainly, is hydrogen. It's a very useful kind of energy vector, and it's kind of starting to creep its way into a lot of the kind of energy strategies and our future climate modelling. And in fact, all of the UK's climate mitigation scenarios that reach net zero have some degree of hydrogen in them. So it really is a kind of important future energy vector. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit more about that. So the great thing about hydrogen in particular is that it's applicable over multiple vectors. And I think one of the really powerful things it can do two things very well. Okay, so first of all, it can help us increase our renewables. So one of the big problems about renewables, of course, is that balance between supply and demand. So we're generating it, but we really don't generate enough for when we need it in those cold winters. So we have a mismatch between the supply and the demand. So we really need some way of storing the energy, whether that be sort of an extra energy we're generating in the summer when we don't need it, or even creating energy for storage. So we need some way to store our energy. And batteries just can't hit the scales that we need. So hydrogen is a really good and powerful energy storage tool to help us up that renewables and keep using them and keep expanding them and keep sort of giving them a wider distribution of use. So it's really powerful that way. But what it can also do is really reach those hard-to-abate sectors, so the sectors that really can't be fixed by cheap renewable electricity. So that's going to be heating in our old housing stock. So it's fine for new builds, but we've got a lot of old housing stock, and 70 to 80% of our homes are heated by natural gas. And moving to electrification might not necessarily be suitable in all of those cases. So hydrogen can replace natural gas in our methane gas grid infrastructure. It can decarbonize the big heavy haulage and big sort of industrial scale transport, freight, rail and shipping. So it's really powerful that. It can also be used to replace hydrocarbon-based feedstocks in industry. So it can decarbonize a lot of those sectors, which on the graph you saw earlier, were really not showing progress. So hydrogen has a power to contribute a little bit to reducing those. And of course, in our current situation with the energy crisis that we're facing at the moment, I don't think it does any harm to have a look at being a little bit more energy resilient, a bit more sustainable in the way that we deal with our energy, and hydrogen reduced particularly from renewables can help us with that. I can't remember. So I don't know how familiar you are with hydrogen, how it's generated, but we've got, at the moment in the debate, there's two types of hydrogen. So there's green hydrogen, which we generate from electrolysis of water using renewable energy, and we have blue hydrogen, which is generated from hydrocarbons. But it's only low carbon, of course, if it's associated with carbon capture and storage. So in a perfect world, the green hydrogen is really the way that we're wanting to go forward, but it's possible that blue hydrogen might have to be an interim sort of staging post while we make this energy transition in a fair and just way. So if I talk to you about hydrogen, where's the geology in all of this? Yeah, hey, I'm at a geology lecture, where's the geology? Let me tell you where the geology is. So hydrogen, as you know, is very light. It's one of the lighter, well, the second lightest element or lightest element in the periodic table. So it has a very high energy density by mass, but a very little mass by volume, which means that to store it, you need large volumes. And if you look at the figure over here, which shows discharge time against system powers of current hydrogen storage technologies, surface tanks, so they can discharge kilowatt hours, or kilowatts and gigawatts over kind of minutes to hours. So they really can only give us about 10,000 kilowatt hours of storage. And putting that into context, that's the average use for a UK household. So we're going to need more than that. We've not all got NASA's budget to store our hydrogen in cryogenic tanks frozen to or cooled to minus 200 degrees. So we need a larger scale storage from that. And as you can see on the diagram, geology and geological storage is really your only option to provide that scale of storage that we need. And these are the scales that we really need to advance these new low carbon technologies for net zero. So when I talk about geological storage, that can be in engineered caverns, in suitable rock formations. It can be in abandoned mine shafts, if possible, with engineered solutions and engineered barriers. It can be in salt caverns, which are dissolution mined out of our salt deposits, and it can be in porous rocks. So these are our options. And each of these options give you an increasing ability to store the increased volumes that we need for net zero. So yay, some rocks. So when I talk about that geological storage and those kind of means of storage, we're looking at those engineered salt caverns, we're looking at those possible depleted oil and gas fields and these saline aquifers. And these are deep. They're deep underground. You know, they really are kilometres underground to keep them safely and securely stored. So looking at the salt caverns, they're around about a kilometre, which is basically as far as walking to Waverley train station. So if I said, oh, you've got to walk over to Waverley train station, you'd be like, oh, that's ages away. So it's a kilometre deep, whereas the deep saline aquifers and the depleted gas fields, they're down to 2 to 3 kilometres away. So that's all the way to Haymarket station if you're walking through the subsurface. You know, so these are deep underground with many, many layers of geology above them to keep these stores secure for storing hydrogen for the future. So talking to you about sort of experience of this and kind of giving you an insight into what we've done already, we have a lot of experience in geological storage of energy in the subsurface already. We have about sort of 100 salt caverns in storing our natural gas at the moment around the world, and we have around about 600 natural gas stores of energy in porous media, so repurposing our depleted gas fields from production to storage. So this is a technology which is really very well advanced and something that we really are comfortable. So again, I'm just going to talk about the porous storage rocks at the moment because those are the ones that give us the biggest opportunity and also quite relevant to Scotland because, of course, we have our oil and gas industry. We have these porous stores of our coastline, and we have the infrastructure, the industry, the know-how. So we have this asset which can be transitioned to that low-carbon journey. So we need a porous and a permeable rock. So the hydrogen sits in that blue bit, in the gaps between the grains in the subsurface. So around about, normally a good reservoir rock has around about sort of 20 to 30% holes between the grains, and that's where the hydrogen sits. We need a seal, we need to keep the hydrogen in place, so we need an impermeable cap rock. So that's something that, like a clay or a shale, or an evaporite, a salt, something that really doesn't, that keeps the rocks in place, something really, really impermeable, so that we don't get any of these hydrogen losses from the subsurface. And we need a trapping structure, so we need a geometry to collect that hydrogen in place. Because we need to inject it and we need to get it back out again over multiple cycles, probably annual cycles. So we really need this trapping structure, we need these nice porous rocks, and we need a really thick cap rock. Normally multiple layers of cap rock in those kilometres of rocks above it. And of course, depleted gas fields, as I mentioned, in Scotland might be a sensible place to start because we already know that they have these components in place. So they're kind of already on our side. So we want to maybe think about the possibility of repurposing some of our depleted gas fields to become storage rocks for hydrogen. So how many of these are we going to need? How much hydrogen do we need to store? How many reservoirs do we need? So that was one of the questions I sort of was thinking, well, how many storers do you think we might need? Say, for example, if we were to replace our natural gas and our heat for hydrogen. So looking at the kind of annual energy storage needs for what we need to currently, we need around about 80 terawatt hours of storage. Okay, so I was like, well, where can we store that? What do you think we're going to need? So we calculated the storage capacity of these, and the map on the kind of wherever, nearest me, basically the blue circles are the gas region demand, storage demand. So that's each of our individual gas regions. They're divided up into regions. So the blue is the individual region's storage needs. So this is not energy demand in total. It's just how much energy storage it needs to balance the summer and the winter, that extra demand in the winter. The blue lines are the pipelines. So that, again, is looking at our existing gas infrastructure. So that's the blue pipelines that are connecting the oil fields and connecting it to the gas terminal. So this is using our existing infrastructure. So the triangles are our gas terminals. The blue lines are our pipelines. And then the circles are our gas fields. So this is just a few of the gas fields. We only looked at about 40 because we thought we might need 40, but turns out we don't. We really just didn't know. So the circles on the capacity estimates are scaled to size basically the total storage capacity with these few fields. There's many more fields. This was just a first look. And basically what we found out that there's thousands actually of terawatt hours storage, hydrogen storage capability in the North Sea. And actually only one field is necessary for to deliver our energy storage needs, which was really quite a surprise to us. I don't know why, but it was quite a surprise. We're looking at one giant, a large offshore. I mean, it wouldn't be sensible to have one because you need resilience and things happen, but basically we don't need them all. But that also is quite good news because if we're starting to think about carbon capture and storage to really bring those CO2 emissions down and continue to tackle these hard to abate areas which will need carbon capture and storage, we're not going to be competing for the subsurface. There's plenty of room for everybody, really. So the next thing to do is, okay, so we've got, you know, we need a large store. Geology's great. We've got plenty stores, and there's more than enough capacity to hold what we need. But are they going to work? Is it going to be suitable for hydrogen storage? Is it going to be feasible in these porous rocks? So this is some of the work that we've been doing with my fabulous colleagues at Edinburgh University and a few other institutions, really looking at that. So this is a UK government or a UKRI Research Council funded project, really investigating the feasibility of these questions. So when you think about the hydrogen storage in the subsurface, a few questions probably come to mind. So first one is the bugs, microbiology. Bugs like eating hydrogen. There's lots of microbes in the subsurface. So is that going to be a problem? Is there going to be reactions within the microbiology that will just basically consume all the hydrogen and turn it into methane, which is really not what we want to do? And are there any chemical reactions that might happen between the rock minerals, the hydrogen and the reservoir fluids? So that's another concern. We want to understand whether we're able to get out the hydrogen that we put in and get it out and put it in and get it out and put it in again over multiple cycles. So we need to understand these flow processes. And we really need to understand how the storage reservoirs work for hydrogen and how to optimize how we manage these storage sites. And very importantly, and I'll be interested to hear your opinions on this, is really what people think about this and how we feel about hydrogen's role in that net zero journey and really what we think we can do and what's permissible under that route map to net zero. So these are the aims of the High Store Poor project. So these are hot off the press results. Some of them are just being published as we speak. But certainly what our work is suggesting is that storage reservoirs, so for the microbiology question, you're thinking, oh gosh, are we going to eat it all? Well, actually, what we've found is that if we looked at the life limits of the bacteria that eat hydrogen, that consume hydrogen, none of them really fare very well when the temperatures are above 120 degrees and whether the salinities are above 4.4 molars. So you can kind of start to think, well, actually, what does that mean in terms of our actual reservoirs? Do we have reservoirs at these temperatures and salinities so that we could select these and really minimise that risk of hydrogen consumption? And yes, we do. We have plenty of those. So we can overlay these conditions into our reservoirs and start to kind of identify reservoirs which may be suitable to minimise that risk of hydrogen loss to subsurface microbes. We've done hundreds of experiments on geochemistry, so we've got vessels just bubbling away the whole time with hydrogen and rocks from reservoir rocks from everywhere around the world, and so far nothing has happened, which is not very exciting academically, but you have to keep saying to yourself, no news is good news, because if nothing happens, that's great. So certainly in all the experiments we've done so far, nothing has happened. And we've really pushed the limits. We've tried to make things happen. You know, we've powdered things, we've used pure minerals, we've really tried to give it the best chance possible of happening. And so far, so good, we can say. The cap rock, that really important kind of sealing. People, you might think, well, methane's a bit denser, it's a bit heavier than hydrogen. Might the hydrogen escape through it? So we've done quite a lot of calculations and experiments on that. And so far, again, it's showing that actually the diffusive losses and that kind of travel into the cap rock should be very minimal. So again, we're really sort of hoping and feel confident that the cap rock should do its job. So we know there's storage capacity, so we know that there's the opportunity to do that. So, and again, as I mentioned, that we've got this kind of minimal competition with the subsurface. And if you're always thinking about these sort of weights and measures and balances of how we use the subsurface for geothermal, for compressed air energy storage, for CO2 storage, and for hydrogen, and they'll all have their own kind of conditions which are optimal for them. And if I take, for example, salinity, I've mentioned that the bugs don't like it very saline. So, for example, for a very saline reservoir, that might be good for hydrogen, but you might not want that for CO2 storage, because actually an increase in salinity reduces the solubility of CO2 in the fluid. So actually reducing the solubility of the CO2 reduces that kind of storage capacity. So actually, there may be a kind of self-sorting arrangement amongst our offshore resources, which kind of lend themselves to different geoenergy and low-carbon energy transition uses. So we've still got a lot to do, a lot of questions still remaining, and I'm sure you may even give us some new ones today and some new insights. I'll look forward to that. So in the second half of the project, we're just going to continue with our experiments, continue with understanding the flow. We're starting to image that flow with X-ray experiments, which is really cool, and really try to understand that role of hydrogen in net zero and its contribution that it can take. So yeah, thank you very much. That's me. Thanks.
Well, thank you so much to all our speakers. I feel so stimulated by that. I don't know, there's something very different about being here, listening to you all, getting so much more than I think if we were all sitting at home on Zoom. Want to open up the floor. I am bursting with questions, but that is not necessarily my job yet. What questions do you have? And please think broadly and think for questions for all our panel today. Angus is standing at the back there, and he does have microphones, and he can come round and use the microphone and so enable everyone to hear. Who wants to go first? Angus, down here, gentlemen. Oh, yes. Now, if you don't particularly want to have a microphone in your face, we've got a clipboard and pens with pens. If you'd rather write down your question and just sort of submit it, and then Angus can read it out. That is an alternative if you don't feel comfortable talking through the mask for any reason.
Thank you for the speeches. I mean, they were quite interesting. I want to raise a point. Everything you were talking about was about resilience and actually preserving the way of life we have now. One thing which strikes me as missing is basically the other effects of climate change, and in particular, the possible failure of the Gulf Stream, which is going to affect Scotland drastically, should it happen. I mean, it would be reduced to the sort of fertility of Baffin Island. What have you ever included any considerations of that in your models? Or have actual any opinion on the possibility of that happening through climate change?
Okay. Thank you very much. Sort of diversifying immediately into wider areas. Would anyone like to pick up on that?
Yeah,
Larissa? Okay.
Yeah. We cover some of the Atlantic salt pump turning off in our first year geography lectures. And colleague and I share those lectures, and they're about to launch in the next few weeks. So yes, there is evidence that that saline pump is slowing down. And just for people to understand, you have Greenland. You currently have a very salty ocean, and that there's a variation in the salinity, which you so eloquently talked about, happens in the ocean. And that creates a pump, and that creates both the Gulf Stream and a pump in the oceans. And that's why we're not as cold as Scandinavia or the Canadian equivalent. You know, we're at the latitude of Labrador, and we would not want, ideally, the climate of Labrador. But yes, if that, and there is some evidence, and increasing evidence, that that saline pump is slowing down. And I guess from a net zero point of view, if we can increase the rate at which we reach net zero, then we're going to decrease the rate at which Greenland melts. Now, some of the research that it's not my expertise, but from a teaching point of view, there is new instrumental data from Greenland showing the scale of the ice loss, not just modeled data. So Greenland's ice mass is shrinking. And what that does is, because a lot of it is on land, is it's adding fresh water to the ocean, and it's diluting it, which is slowing down that pump, which means the Gulf Stream is going to slow down. And so is that pump that's keeping us quite temperate. So that will have consequences from an energy point of view, which I can pass along the table. But from what Freya and I talked about, it makes very little difference other than its impact on sea level rise. Yeah. Other than the effects of those storms will be much colder and icier. Yeah. But in terms of the actual risks around coastal change, not much difference in terms of our livability and our habitability and our energy requirements and how we build houses. That's a different question. So the climate resilient development pathways have to involve that kind of scenario, I think, is a short answer. You may be able to.
Yeah, no, I completely. Yes, I completely agree. And I think you're absolutely right. It's not so much it's more of a practical change that our energy use, we will adapt and we will use more energy and wear more jumpers. I think we're, certainly from an energy point of view, we are looking to decarbonize what we use already rather than anticipating that change. But the climate modelers will be working on that.
Okay. Thank you very much. We've got, I mean, I'm hoping to get through as many questions as possible, 10, 15 minutes, but, we'll be finishing, but then perhaps there will be opportunities to pick up for further discussion with the speakers at the end. Has anyone got another question they would like to come in with now? Okay, Angus, strictly speaking over the other side of the room, but maybe we'll come here first for ease and then go over to you.
Hi, very interesting talks as well. Relating to another modelling type question, but with the new IPC policymaker report coming out, surprised to see that in talking about ice sheets, there's only moderate confidence, I think they said, on the potential of a 2 metre sea level rise. And obviously that's catastrophic. But what we thought was really interesting with the sea level rise talk was that the soft kind of coastlines that you talk about, will there be a scenario where we need to abandon a lot of our coastal habitats, if not because the sea levels rise, or we will need to abandon them for the use of nature-based solutions because we need that? So, is there a potential of some sort of like clearance of the coastlines where we need to be moving inland? Or any comments there?
Yeah.
Take my mask off. There we go. Yeah, absolutely. We have, you know, we can only model the changes to the shoreline, the future shoreline, with the information that we have to be able to put into that model. So using that, the UKCP 18 sea level rise projections of up to a meter can only get us so far in terms of predicting for those kind of, that the kind of futures that we might expect by 2050 and 2100. But there is the potential for there to be, you know, as you say, a catastrophic sort of rise in sea level, which could have huge impacts on some of our coastal communities. And part of the kind of adaptation and the way that we respond to that change is by, you know, the potential for moving inland, moving assets, abandoning assets, as we had the photo from Bedbecula. Yeah, there's definitely a potential for that. I don't know if there's
UK's Committee on Climate Change produced a report in 2018 for England, and there's currently 8,000 houses at risk of coastal erosion in England. That's going to skyrocket to 100,000 by 2100. And so there will need to be some retreat and abandonment and or policy mechanisms by which we can facilitate that move. So there's a twin track. We've got to think about, you know, I focused on the easy one tonight in my talk. Easy being, let's make climate resilient, smart development decisions now where we're choosing to redevelop. Moving existing developments is a different kettle of fish because of all the community place-based you know, situation. Equally, we're much easier than somewhere like Bangladesh. So there's a global amplifier, and we all have to globally embrace, you know, immigration, because there will be massive climate migration, because most of Bangladesh is 1 or 2 meters above sea level. It houses a huge amount of the world's population. So there will be large geographic and demographic shifts in society, and we're only just starting to accept that. And so it's about how do we transform our relationship with the landscape so that it is, you know, habitable, that we can still have, you know, a resilient lifestyle alongside the need to, you know, mitigate rapidly. And both are needed.
Okay. Thank you. Angus, question over there. Oh, thank you.
Thank you all very much. It's been really fascinating. I noticed recently that that opinion former Jeremy Clarkson is promoting hydrogen as the future for fuel for cars rather than electric cars, hydrogen fuel cars. But my question, perhaps for Katie or any of you, is I have recently ordered a consignment of 30 tree saplings to plant. Is that the best way or even a good way to help the battle against CO2?
So I think when it comes to modern plants, obviously there is a lot of carbon dioxide taken into that biomass, but the main thing is about how it's stored. And I think because it, like modern trees and a sapling likely will grow and then die, and that material will just be recycled back into it. But obviously while it's living, you are extracting some carbon dioxide, but you do need to have that proper carbon sink and that burial of the carbon to counteract the levels.
I'll turn my garden into a peat bog at the same time. Thank you.
I'll just add something to that, because I was on a proposal. Phil Renforth, who's at Heriot Watt, is one of the leading experts in the field. But there's... I'm a biogeomorphologist by training, so it makes sense. But how the tree, where you plant trees and which type of trees you plant interacts with the subsurface, including the geology. And so there was a bid that I was involved in to look at some rock types are more suitable for certain tree types than others. And we might actually be inadvertently releasing carbon through planting trees on the wrong geology. And or vice versa, you may amplify the effect. So it actually, we need to start thinking about this critical zone and this three dimensions, and carefully thinking about those biochemical interactions that are operating, as well as just the above ground storage.
Yeah, no, I think you're right. I was reading a big article about trees, and it's right place, right tree, right reason, and it shows how integral the science is to all these decisions and all these measures that we can take. It's really critical. Okay, more questions from the floor? Well, Yeah, Angus?
I was just reflecting on your presentations and a lot of really exciting solutions, particularly, I guess, the knowledge that coastal change is coming and the impacts of that, and also hydrogen. I mean, are you optimistic? Are we heading in the right direction?
I think that's a great question. Are you glass half full people or glass half empty?
I think as academics we have to be a bit glass half full and be, you know, keep going, keep going.
I guess I'd say that more to the point is that as I've moved on in my career, and I've worked in industry, I've worked in government, and I've worked in academia, but I guess the science can only take us so far. And we have to do things like this, a public lecture. We have to engage with the planners, as we've been doing. Presumably you engage with other stakeholders. So I guess our science is changing, and it needs to change, and we're not necessarily lobbyists, but on the other hand, we have to engage in those spaces, and we need to create societal systems that allow for that. Mm-hmm. So academics, situation, you know, academic performance indicators of income targets, which we all have, how do we balance that with the need? We've just finished Dynamic Coast Project, and can we spend a year, and who finances us doing the sharing? And spending time with individual local authorities to make the changes. And how do we, and there is impact agenda and things like that, and time scales, but really, you know, we need new innovation, but we also need to share and co-produce and co-design with communities, with politicians, with government officers to help make that change. And I think that, to me, is, so we need to make sure our systems provide that kind of space to enable the shifts that are necessary to be catapulted forward.
So can I ask how COP fits into that, you know, in 4 weeks' time? Do you feel excited and sort of energized by the prospect of that taking place? Is that where the right conversations that you're talking about can take place? This is, I mean, I'm not expecting you all to be experts on the COP process. I'm just wondering how optimistic we should be in the face of the conference about to start.
I mean, just in the last few years, I'm sure you all agree that the dialogue has changed. That sense of urgency is definitely there that wasn't there maybe 5 years ago. So there is a tangible feeling of change. Whether that actually, it will, you know, in time, I think changes will be made. And I think it's really exciting to see that. You know, it's really very noticeable in the, and I think COP is arriving at, almost at the right time, you know. You know, before David Attenborough, he's getting quite old, you know, so we don't, you know, he's got to keep going for a few more years. We need him as a spokesperson, but you know, these kind of, you know, these high level dialogues and that kind of engagement with the society that, you know, David Attenborough, for example, is just a UK example, but Greta Thunberg, you know, they really are engaging with all kind of societies, whether that's a good or a bad engagement, it doesn't matter. People are talking about it, so I think COP is certainly.
Yeah.
Almost at the right, you know, at the right time, but whether actions can be put in place.
Yeah.
You know, we've got a global situation which is quite the priority at the moment. So yeah.
I think the really inspiring thing as well is, particularly from an early career researcher point of view, I feel like this is the first time that we're really seeing that young people's engagement and that sort of fresh faces of climate action stepping up, which is really inspiring, and it's really wonderful to see. But it also, I guess, can be slightly tinged with a little bit of sadness that it's this sort of burden that feels like it's being placed on the shoulders of these sort of young innovators. So in one sense, I guess it's inspiring to see, you know, COP26 be that stage and Glasgow be that stage for all of these young activists. But it's the actual actions of the decision makers and the people who hold the power that will really be the sort of telling kind of move from it, I guess.
Yeah. Any other questions from the floor?
Yeah, no, that's okay.
Yeah, I just wanted to bring up the hydrogen now. I suppose it's in two parts. So we're talking about the energy transition, But if you think about with climate change, we're warming in our climates, and we're, you know, maybe in the future we're maybe experiencing, you know, heat waves and maybe less cold winters. So is that something to think about when we're thinking about our energy transition? That do we need maybe as much heating? You know, is that something to think about? And also, trying to bring some sea level rise into it, I noticed that all of our industry seems to be on the East Coast. Is it well protected? You know, is sea level rise going to be a problem for industry on the East Coast as well? Is the coastline good there? I don't know.
It's a great question, because actually it pulls all of us together, because it's also tied to our geological history and our industrial sort of legacy as well, actually. So to answer your first question, heating uses three or four times more energy cooling is three or four times more energy demanding than heating. So actually, if we need more cooling, we're in a bigger problem. So yes, that's going to have a really big impact on our energy use. But certainly from the sea level, and I mean, if we start with Katie and just that link to our industrial legacy and that that location of that.
Yeah, and I think when you look particularly around the Forth and the Fife coast, it's quite clear that, you know, this erosion is taking place. You see it on a pretty much daily basis. The rocks, the coastline looks very, very different. And obviously a lot of the old industry, that's slightly different, because it's, you know, one of the problems with that is you're then eroding into all this, like, sort of industrial waste that you don't really want to be doing, because nowadays you wouldn't be allowed to dump it like it happened back then. But with terms to like other industry, I guess that's probably something that they would look into in planning, I think, when they're, you know, looking forward. But yeah, I think my knowledge is more around like sort of the historic industry of the Forth.
So I had some extra slides.
I actually had to give a keynote with the university in Taiwan last week, and this was one of the slides. But it kind of links all of these things in that we have this big push for offshore renewables, for wind. We have to think about where we site the pipe strings. How do we connect it to the land? Where do we connect it to the land? And is that a climate resilient place? So Dynamic Coast 2 data has been actually used. The data here is just illustrative. It's the same. It's, Freya, actually, where is that? Because I don't know.
It's actually, originally it was taken and kind of for sensitive purposes. So it's actually Cullen Harbour, but it's been rotated, if anyone knew their coastlines. But so it's on the north coast.
So the one of a site around Scotland, I'm not 100% sure of the geography, but the Dynamic Coast 1 data was actually used to change the planning conditions, because they were going to basically run the pipe string through the red zone. And if we do that, you then have to defend it. Mm-hmm. And this is about designing new infrastructure in places that has climate resilience. And it's really, really important. And Bacton was on your slides, and I've worked in Norfolk and Suffolk, and 40% of gas comes through Bacton. Bacton had a 20 million pound sand engine project, which is a Dutch style nature-based solution where you pump sand and then you let it kind of recirculate. There's huge numbers of communities that are protected at Bacton, including all of the Broads. It's a good example of this erosion induced flooding. If the beaches go and the dunes go, then the Broads are gone, because we made the Broads. The Broads are not natural. There's a lot of internationally important birds living in them, but we created those habitats. Are we prepared to let them go? But if you go back to Bacton, you know, I would say, in terms of thinking about hydrogen storage and CO2 storage, do we want to continue to pump 20 million pounds repeatedly into Bacton? Or do we want to say, okay, let's become energy resilient, let's no longer need that as our gas supply mm-hmm. into the UK, and let's definitely not use it as a site for either CO2 or hydrogen storage, because maybe some of the other places it's coming onto land are more resilient. So we need to think systemically and holistically and transformatively across all of these disciplinaries and multi-scales of governance and private sector and public sector to solve some of these problems. Mm-hmm. And going back to your COP question, that's what we need to see out of COP. We need to see a real willingness to deal with those thorny issues of artifacts of our society, of our privatization of multiple strands of, say, infrastructure provision, alongside multiple levels of governance, alongside the equity that comes from us having produced most of the CO2 emissions to start with, particularly when we had an empire. We need to pay more. So it's those really big things, I think, will shift strong decisions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Larissa, I think you've just sort of concluded so well. I think we should leave the discussion there. I don't think COP is long enough, actually, to achieve that. But what I really do hope is that COP26 will be a massive part of moving forward with that, and mm-hmm. COP27 will then, you know, begin achieving that. I'm not going to say any more. I'm going to hand over to Tom now, who's going to wrap up tonight's proceedings. But thank you very much from me.
Yes. Well, I think we all understand climate is complicated. And climate change is even more complicated because you add in this element of time. And mitigating against climate change is even more complicated, again, because it involves people. And that's very tricky. But what I think we have seen tonight is a sort of a ray of hope, really. I mean, and Hermione was saying, are you glass, you know, half full or half empty? And hearing this kind of research that's been done, and that's research from all elements of geological gamut, you know, that's from the Carboniferous into present-day geomorphology and into future hydrogen storage, for instance, that, I think, gives us the ability to look at this problem, this climate crisis, with a glass half full attitude. And hearing all the talks tonight makes me, as a geologist, paleontologist, feel very proud. And I think we should all feel very proud that our science here is addressing not just these big academic problems, but these big societal problems as well. So geology is not just about, I don't know, identifying a new fossil or something like that. It's not just about sort of, you know, working out how much hydrogen flows through a bit of sandstone. It's all of these things together. And that, I think, is one of the most important things we have to understand of the privilege that we are in as geological scientists, and the power that we have going into a huge, huge, globally important conference such as COP26. And I think I'd like to thank all the speakers here tonight for showing how important our science is in the run-up to something like COP26 and the impact and the influence that we can have on changing this global climate crisis. So thank you very much, Katie, Catriona, Freya, and Larissa, for all your talks, your stimulating conversations and talks, and for all your questions as well tonight. And thank you especially to everybody for coming out here tonight for our first, in goodness knows how long, in-person lecture. Unfortunately, our future lectures are going to have to be back on Zoom because the university has not granted us the ability to come back into the establishment. So we're in a very privileged position here tonight. So thank you ever so much, and thank you to the audience as well.
And I'd just like to say thank you to the Geological Society for inviting us, but also it's pretty impressive to have four women speakers and a woman panelist. And, you know, we have to transform, and who would have thought the society 100 years ago would have had that? What is 100 years from now going to look like? And you know, touché, guys.